step back from the mic so I wouldn't mess up that singing. Great singing. Thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful encouraging and lifting worship devotion.
Yeah.
And thank you so much, Brother Ellis, for such an encouraging and supportive introduction.
Amen.
The trust that you have placed in me, I take very seriously. And I do appreciate the privilege of being here and working with you and this congregation in this series of gospel meetings. And it's awful good to see Brother Ellis Sr. in the audience today.
Amen.
I look forward to seeing him, and I know he has been sick, and I was kind of like Paul was, that his friend was sick, and he was looking forward to hearing from him. And I've been listening to see how you're doing, and it's so good to see you again today.
Amen.
My spirit is revived, and I rejoice at your presence in this assembly on this morning. Mm-hmm. It's always good to have with me my wife, Laura. She's been with me on a number of occasions.
Amen.
Some of y'all probably haven't met her as yet. And so, Sister Laura, would you just stand, and so the audience can see that you're with me.
Amen.
Enjoy making this journey together, and I don't intend to be the reason that you are late in your next appointment. I don't want you to put that on me. I don't want to have to live that through the rest of this week. And so I'm going to do my best not to be the one and that causes the delay that would cause you to have to be in a bigger hurry than necessary.
Right.
We are thankful to God for the manifold blessings that He bestowed upon us, and we're excited about being together today that we might worship Him and give Him the glory and honor and the praise.
Amen.
In our lives. And I want to invite you to study with me today in the fear of the judgment to come.
Yes.
Realizing that one day we must stand before the God of our being and give an account of the things done in our bodies.
Yes, sir.
Whether they're good or whether they're evil. Amen. Jesus said, "He that rejecteth me and receiveth not my word as one that judges him. The word that I've spoken, the same will judge him in the last day."
Amen.
John said, "I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God."
Preach.
And the books were opened, and another book was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books.
Yes.
Whosoever was not found written in the book of life were cast into the lake of fire.
Yes.
We are standing on the edge of life with the future ahead of us.
Right.
And in that future is either a privilege to be good with God in heaven, or to be resigned to a place away from God, mm-hmm. which is called hell. Mm-hmm. I choose heaven.
Amen.
I want to make heaven my home.
Right.
I want to go to heaven when I die.
Amen.
When this whole world is destroyed, and when all things are terminated in this life,
right.
I want a place with God in the after while. And I invite you to come take the journey with me. If you're visiting with us today and you're not a member of the Church of Christ, we're awful glad to have you present.
Amen.
Our trust and prayer is that your being with us will be as encouraging and as inspiring for you as having you is for us. And we trust that you'll be so encouraged that the Word of God will minister grace and goodness to your heart and food to your soul.
Yeah.
And that you want to hear more and more of what God's Word has to say.
Yes.
We can be of some assistance to you. Just let us know that we like together take up the bloodstained banner of Jesus Christ and march down the King's highway until we're called from labor to reward.
Yes. Yeah.
The message that I want to share with you today, and throughout this series of meetings, I'm going to be dealing with the same theme throughout this week, and because I believe that Christians are people who want to go to heaven, and one of the greatest things we can do about revival is remind us of our goal.
Okay.
Remind us of where it is we're hoping to go and planning to go. This series is designed for three groups of people. I want this message to reach to those who are not saved, those who are not part of the Lord's people, and to invite you to come to Jesus Christ and become part of the journey toward heaven.
Yes.
This message is also to those who have obeyed the gospel but are backslidden, and you're hanging on the threads, and eternity is rapidly approaching, and that you return to the Lord and begin to be faithful to Him again.
Amen.
It's also to those who struggle under the pressures of life, and people who deal with issues that make it difficult for them to make it through life, to give you something to hold on to and remind you that there's a better land and a better world than what we're dealing with now. And so each person has something to look forward to, but I trust that you'll find your portion in the work of Word of God as we study together today.
Yes.
And when I talk about heaven, there's a passage of scripture that really is set by John to initiate this process of getting people headed toward heaven. Mm-hmm. The Gospel of John chapter 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shineth in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
Yes.
There was a man sent from God whose name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe.
Yes.
He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light.
Uh-huh.
That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world.
Yes.
He was in the world, and the world was made by him, and the world knew him not.
Yes.
He came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, them gave he the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name.
Amen.
I want to show you that what John does, John's gospel is a connection with the book of Revelation. For John in the gospel introduces Christ as the beginning of our salvation. And John in Revelation presents Christ as the conclusion of our salvation.
Amen.
He introduces him as the one who came from eternity to past and came into time, born of a virgin, and lived among men. But he's going to show us that same Christ coming back at the end of the day to receive unto himself the glorious church without spot or wrinkle or any such thing.
Right.
So there's a connection between these two passages of scripture.
Yeah.
And I want you to understand that what John shows in chapter 1 is that man became in reality an enemy of Jesus Christ and of God the Father.
Yeah.
What transpired was that God created the world and placed man in the world.
Right.
And then gave man instruction that of every tree of the garden you may freely eat. But of the tree that's in the midst of the garden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you may not eat it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die.
Right.
But you know what happened.
Yes.
Man didn't obey God.
Right.
He rejected the will of God.
Right.
What Adam did in the garden is kind of like the situation of a great epidemic that takes place in the medical world. A person comes down with a very serious disease, and the disease is a communicable disease because it's catching. You can pass it on to other folk.
Yes.
And so the person who has it becomes the carrier of the disease.
Yes.
And those who contact him become the receivers and become also carriers of the disease. The problem is that the disease has growing characteristics. In the first stage, once the doctors have examined the patient and began to try to figure out what's wrong, before they can figure out how to cure that disease, it's been passed on to somebody else. But every time it passes on to somebody else, it takes on new qualities and new symptoms. So that the doctors are always scratching their head because they can never get ahead. Every time they think they've got it cornered and they'll be able to wrap it up, it takes on some new issues and it begins to move in different directions, and it's always expanding and growing and becoming something that it wasn't before. And they call in the greatest doctors in the city, and they were scratching their heads and can't do anything about it. And then they look out around the state and they call in the great doctors in the state, but when they think they've whipped it, it takes them, and they're not able to do it. And so they go national and they call all the doctors in that they know, but those doctors are baffled to figure out how to keep it from continuing to grow and become worse than it was before. Finally, they figure, well, we need to call in the greatest doctors in the world. They call the greatest doctors in the world in. And they gather together and put their notes and minds together. And about time they think they have figured out how to whip this disease. It comes up with new issues and new symptoms, and they're baffled to figure it out. The world is going crazy, and people are getting afraid, and people are wondering if they will ever get it under control. Then finally, they find one unknown doctor, a doctor that they have not even considered before. And they call him in, and he comes in, and he looks at the situation, he examines the evidence, and he tells them, we can solve the problem. I want you to know that the medical world is still scratching its head about many diseases that it cannot cure. But the diseases they're dealing with is not the greatest disease that keep changing every time it goes to another person. The greatest disease that keep changing every time it goes to another person is a disease that came about in the Garden of Eden. When man ate of the forbidden fruit, the disease of sin and death passed on to man. And every person that gets the disease of sin and death manifests that sinfulness in different ways, and it's always a new way to sin. And we're looking today at new manufacturers of sin taking place all over the land. We are baffled to figure out how we're going to stop it. But a long time ago, they found a doctor that was an unusual doctor. He didn't come from the great schools and universities, but he came through the process of time, through the portals of glory, down to a virgin birth, born in Bethlehem of Judea. He offered a cure for the sins of the world, but his cure is not going to be found in a medical lab or a hill far away. Stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. It was on that cross that the blood of Jesus Christ was poured out for the sins of the world. And it's that blood that cleanses man of his sins and cures him of the disease of sin. And that blood is available to men today. The Bible says that we walk in the light as he is in the light. We have fellowship one with another. The blood of Christ the Son cleanseth us from all unrighteousness. The blood of Jesus is the cure for the sins of the world. And it is access in the water grave of baptism for the forgiveness of our sins. In baptism, we make contact with the blood. In baptism, the blood is applied to the worst condition that man has ever had. And in washing away the sin, it provides a covering for man that removes the stain of sin from his life and brings him back before God, accounted righteous by the blood of Jesus Christ. See, John in essence says, in step Jesus. In the midst of all the calamities of the world, Jesus steps in. Because man's predicament had just gotten terrible. He yielded to sin. He lost his home. He lost his blessing. He lost his life. He lost his wife. He lost his place with God. Things began to get worse with Adam. And Adam's descendant got caught the germ of sin. And it introduced a new kind of murder into the world and false worship into the world. And it just kept on growing. And when the world got so bad that it was filled with violence everywhere, and the imagination and thoughts of man was only evil continually, God sent a flood to cleanse the world of the evil and corruption. Saved a family by the name of Noah. Noah's wife, his son, and their wives. Then God started over again. But sin still crept in the world. And finally, God then brought Jesus. And here you and I are. And the answer to our sin problem is available to us today. We don't have to fall in the degradation of sin and remain eternally, because God has an eternal cure for the sin problem of the world. The real issue is that the reason sin is still spreading, and the reason sin is becoming rampant in the land, is because everybody that's been infected by it are not taking the remedy for it. They're not appealing to the source of healing. And as a result of that, they are continuing to pass it on to others. And I want you to know that what happened in Eden is the reason for what's happening today. And whenever a person violates God's law and walks in rebellion against God, he sends a message to generations to come to rebel against God and refuse to obey God. And that's exactly what Paul was showing the Romans in Romans chapter 1. When it says, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, unto the Jew first and also to the Greek. For therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith.
Amen.
Notice, the next thing Paul says is that the wrath of God is revealed to all unrighteousness of men who hold the truth of God in unrighteousness. Because when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, but became vain in their imagination, their foolish heart was dark. The Bible says that man kept walking in sin and kept passing sin on. And do you know in Romans chapter 1, there's a continuous line of digression and descending as it relates to sin? Now, if you got Romans 1, I just want to show you this right quickly here. Romans 1, pick up at verse 19. And watch what Paul says.
Because that which may be known of God is manifest in them.
That which may be known of God is manifest in them.
For God has shown it unto them.
See, God has revealed his truth, and man has rebelled against it. And watch this.
For the invisible things of him,
from the creation
of the world, are clearly seen.
God has shown us, both by word and by creation, the truth about righteousness in God. Watch this.
Being understood by the things that are made,
even his eternal power in Godhead,
so that they are without excuse.
They are without excuse.
Amen.
Read the text.
Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God.
They glorified him not as God.
Neither were thankful.
They were not thankful to God.
Watch what
Paul says. They glorified him not as God, and they were not thankful to God. You see, two of the greatest things man does, don't need that, in contribution to the spread of sin in the world, is the unthankful attitude that man has, and the failure to give God the glory he deserves. We recognize everything and everybody but God. We wear the jerseys of our favorite ball players. But we don't give God the time of day. And said because of that, they glorified him not as God, and neither were they thankful, but became what?
Vain
in their imagination, and their foolish heart was dark. Because they did not glorify God, and because they failed to be thankful to God, their vanity became the basis of their continued corruption. And because of that, the Bible says what?
Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools.
They misplaced wisdom for words. They thought because they had the ability to accept the ways of the world, it meant that they were wise. And what's going on in our world today is wisdom being misplaced with worldliness. We think we're wise because we can accept homosexuality and lesbianism, and we think that we have arrived because we have a heart that can see all of that and accept all of that. But the Bible says they were misplacing the wisdom. And they were actually becoming worldly and turning against God. And watch the text.
And change the glory of the uncorruptible God.
In so doing this, they were changing the glory of God into what?
Into an image.
Image
made like a corruptible
man.
And to birds.
The birds.
And four-footed
beasts. And creeping things. He says that instead of giving God the glory and worshiping God, They have begun to worship the creature rather than the creator. And as a result, they then are walking in iniquity. What are you saying, Paul? I'm saying that sin kept getting worse and worse and worse. Because when sin is unchecked by the blood of Jesus Christ, it continues to get worse. The only serum that can reduce the quality of sin and remove it from our lives is the blood of Jesus applied to us in baptism for the remission of our sin. Text says what?
Wherefore God also gave them to uncleanness.
And God, the Bible says that because of the direction they were going and the unwillingness to change that course, God did what?
Gave them up.
I want you to read it again. That's why I said
Wherefore God also gave them to uncleanness.
He gave them up to uncleanness.
Through the lust of their own heart.
Through the lust of their own heart.
To dishonor their own bodies.
To dishonor their own bodies.
Between themselves.
Read.
Who changed the truth.
And changed the truth of God into a lie. And worship and serve the creature more than the creator who is blessed forever. Amen. And read the text.
For this cause.
God gave them over.
To vile affections. And even their women did change their natural.
If you want to know where it came from, it didn't come from intelligence. It didn't come from wisdom. It didn't come from insight. It didn't come from righteousness. It came from rebellion against God. And God gave them over because they rebelled against him and would not walk in his ways and keep his commands. Now in verse number 30 and 32, in order to save time and move forward, the text says what?
Backbiters, haters of God, despiteful,
proud,
boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents,
Inventors of evil things. They're inventing things. More evil is being invented. Keep going.
Disobedient to parents. Without understanding.
Covenant breakers.
Without natural affection.
Implacable.
Unmerciful. Who knowing the judgment of God.
Who knowing the judgment of God.
And they which commit such things.
Are worthy of death.
Not only do the same.
I want to make sure you get that.
Yes.
He's not saying not only that. He's saying not only the ones that do it.
Yes, sir.
But also them that have pleasure in those that do it.
Amen.
It says that if you encourage it,
that's it,
or if you're doing it, the end result is going to be the same.
Yes, sir.
Just a little flash notice for you. Some of us encourage things that we don't even think about that we're encouraging. See, our favorite movies are full of nothing but filth and corruption. The number one shows on television that we gotta hurry up and get through with stuff so we can go back and watch. Of folk who live in the low-down dirt as life possible. And they are the stars that we want to see. You know I'm telling the truth? And if that is what we like to see, how then can we really put forth a message that we really don't think is the right way to go?
Amen.
Good point.
So Paul says that in spite of the fact that the gospel is God's power to save, man isn't appealing to the power of God. He's abandoning the power of God and going his own way. And God is giving him up to his damnation, which is to come. Because the outcome of that is damnation.
Yes.
Well, what does that have to do with heaven? What it has to do with heaven is this, that if that's the way we're headed, is not the way to heaven.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
That's right.
That is only one way to heaven.
Amen.
And that way is to follow Jesus and surrender completely unto him.
Amen.
Jesus came into this world that he might draw men to God. In Hebrews chapter 2 and verse number 9, the Hebrew writer is going to show us that Jesus went through tremendous stuff. Remember, John is taking us back
and bringing us to the incarnation, the birth of Jesus Christ into the world, and showing us that he came here in order that he might save men. And the text shows the conflict between men and God when it says that he came to his own and his own received him not.
That's right.
They rejected the one that created them and the one that came to save them. But Jesus' purpose of coming was to save us, that we might take us to God. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse number 9, the scripture says.
But we see Jesus.
We see Jesus.
Who was made a little lower than
the angels. Made a little lower than the angels.
For the suffering of death.
For the suffering of death.
Crowned with glory and honor.
Now read that again.
But we see Jesus.
We see Jesus.
Who was made a little lower than the angels.
Made a little lower than the angels.
For the suffering of death.
Now when the Bible says was made a little lower than the angels, it don't mean that he was created under the angels. It means that he came under the angels. He came down on the level of men because he had a purpose. And he suffered for the suffering of death. Read.
Crowned with glory and honor. That
is a purpose statement. Telling you what the reason is, right. That he,
by the grace of God,
should taste death
for every man.
It says that Christ became a human,
yes.
That he might die for all humans.
Yes.
Why was he going to die for all humans? Read.
It became him. For whom are all things.
And by whom all things.
In bringing men and sons to glory.
To make the captain of that salvation
perfect through suffering.
The Bible says that in order to change our future and perfect us before God, Jesus had to suffer and die in our place. That's what John is introducing to us. And that's what Revelation is showing us the conclusion of. Introduced in John and concluded in Revelation, that we might make in heaven our home. I read.
For both he that sanctifies,
and they who are sanctified,
are all of one. For which cause?
He is not ashamed.
To call them brethren.
The Bible says that Jesus is really, despite how perfect he is and how righteous he is ready to be your elder brother.
Amen.
The problem is, we're not ready to be his younger brothers and younger sisters. We want to go our own way.
Amen.
Going our own way will lead us to destruction. What last verse you read?
He is not ashamed to call them brethren.
Uh-huh.
Saying, I will declare thy name to my brethren.
In the midst of the church, will I sing praise unto thee. All right. Now, what verse was that?
12.
Go drop down and read verse 14 for me.
For as much then as the children are partakers of flesh and blood, he also himself.
He took part of the same.
Likewise took part of the same. That through death.
That through death.
He might destroy him.
He might destroy him.
And have the power.
That has the power of death.
That is the devil.
Now get this. Why does the devil want Adam and Eve to eat of the forbidden fruit that they might die? Why? Because Satan's business is death. God's business is life. Satan's business is death. Everything about Satan will end in death. Even Satan himself will be cast into the lake of fire. He's about death. The Lord is about life. He came to defeat death that he might give us life. That's why Paul said to Corinthians in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, I say that flesh and blood should not inherit the kingdom of God. Neither shall corruption in heaven and corruption. But I show you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet, the trumpet shall sound. And the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed.
Yes.
This one put off incorruption, this one put on immortality, revenge, and brought the past the same. That is written that death is swallowed up in victory. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is thy victory? The sting of death is sin, the strength of sin and all. But thanks be to God who gave us the victory through Jesus Christ. Our Lord, the victory comes through Jesus Christ, my Lord.
Amen.
He knocks at the door of our hearts, taking entrance into our heart and life, saying, come to me all that labor and to heaven laden.
Yeah.
and I'll give you rest.
Yes.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of my meek and lowly heart. You shall find rest to your souls.
Amen.
You come to Christ by hearing his word.
Yes,
you come by believing with all of your heart.
Yes.
You come by repenting of every sin.
Yes.
By confessing faith in Christ as the Son of God.
Yes.
By being buried with him in the water of grave of baptism,
right,
for the forgiveness of your sins.
Right.
In baptism, God will wash away your sins.
Yes.
God will cleanse you, and God will save you, and God will forgive you. And then when you rise from that grave,
yes,
he'll add you to the church of Christ.
Yes, sir.
So that you can live a faithful life unto death. After a while and by, go home to live with God,
yeah,
in the city of the bliss beyond this veil of tears.
Yeah.
No sorrow, sickness, pain, nor death,
right,
for the former things are passed away.
Right.
I want you to understand that heaven ought to be your goal,
yeah,
because I want to go to heaven when I die.
Yeah.
This evening I'm going to be talking about how to be blessed. And then I'm going to deal with the idea of how to know whether I'm going to heaven.
Yes.
I'll deal with the idea of something you need on your journey on the next night.
Amen.
And then I'll close by dealing with the land of no more.
Yes.
I want you to take the journey with me, for it's knocking at the door of your heart today. I wouldn't want to leave you today without obeying Jesus Christ,
amen,
without allowing him to lead me on the journey.
Yes.
The journey Christ leads you on, he'll never leave you alone. He said, I'll be with you always.
Oh,
even to the end of the world.
Amen.
He won't abandon us and he won't forsake us. That's better than the best friends we have.
Amen.
Is to have Jesus in our lives.
Amen.
And he can deal with the only real problem that can keep you out of heaven.
Yes.
Poverty won't keep you out of heaven.
Yes.
Wealth won't keep you out of heaven.
Right.
You know what will keep you out?
Sin.
It's sin.
Yes.
And Jesus can deal with the sin problem.
Amen.
Why not say yes to him today? In fact, why not come right now, while we stand, while we sing, the Savior says, come. You've heard his word.
Believe
with all of your heart, repent of every sin. Confess before me, and have you baptized for the remission of your sin.
I will be pouring souls to Calvary.